This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Corning Egg Farm Book by Corning Himself. By Edward Corning and Gardner Corning. Introductory. The method and the style of the buildings evolved and worked out on the Corning Egg Farm, when put into book form, proved so helpful to so vast a number of poultry keepers that the sale of this first literature, which for a time was added to as the months went by, reached the enormous total of over 140,000 copies in 18 months. The writings were the simple, plain statements of facts, and enabled others who followed them to reach a success which, until this system was used, may have been dreamed of, but was never realized. The literature from this farm has gone out over the entire civilized world, and the visitors, who arrive in ever-increasing numbers from month to month, come from every quarter of the globe. The Corning Egg Farm has been written of in periodicals of every nature and in almost every language the world over. For the last 12 months, the requests for further and more explicit, detailed information relative to breeding and feeding for eggs, the specialty from which the Corning Egg Farm has never swerved, have become a demand. So that, after mature deliberation, it was decided to write the history of the Corning Egg Farm from its inception to date, including the work of the last 2 years, which has never before been fully published. The Corning Egg Farm Book by Corning Himself is today the only publication giving facts in regard to the farm and its unique method right up to date. As the book is read, it must be borne in mind that in breeding to produce a great layer, at first very marked increases in the number of eggs during the first 10 months of laying may be gained. The general average number of eggs laid each year, from official reports, is less than 100 per hen. On the Corning Egg Farm, when the average had reached 143.25 eggs, the next jump, in the following year, was more than had been expected, and the record of 145.11 eggs for each hen for 10 months, though showing an increase apparently small, in reality, was a very great advance indeed. From this time on, the gain, although representing a narrower margin of increase, was in reality a much greater achievement. The trotting horse may serve as an illustration. When Dexter trotted his famous mile, he clipped off a number of seconds from the previous record, and it seemed as if it would be a matter of considerable time before his mark would be lowered. But within a comparatively short time, a number of trotters turned off a mile in 2:10, and from this figure, within a short period, a large company of famous horses had reached the 2:05 mark. But every quarter of a second, which reduced this mark, meant greater achievement in breeding than was represented by the reduction of records from 2:16 to 2:05, and we have not yet seen the horse which, in single harness, without a running mate, can turn the mile track in 2 minutes flat. The Corning Egg Farm realizes that from this on, improvement will be shown by fractional figures, but these fractions will represent a greater progress than the figures which have gone before. 2 years ago, the unequaled results of the Corning Egg Farm had seemed unsurpassable. But today we are able to look back from higher ground and see the road over which we have traveled to reach a point very considerably beyond the unequaled position of 2 years ago. It is our hope and aim, year by year, to improve the present position. The man who believes he has learned all there is to learn is a failure. The successful man is the one who is sure there is an opportunity to advance considerably beyond the point he has already attained, and the Corning Egg Farm believes this to be true and has constantly worked with that idea before it. With an experience back of them of nearly 6 years, the builders of the Corning Egg Farm know that this book furnishes the necessary guide for success in poultry culture. What has been and what is being done at the Corning Egg Farm is not experimental work. Successful results follow the method and system employed as surely as day follows night. It is no longer necessary for the novice to try out the various plans proposed to him by the literary poultryman, whose methods are worked out on a mahogany desk, with pen and ink, or more often, perhaps, by dictation to a stenographer. Years of careful thought and study, and the expenditure of much time and many thousands of dollars in developing the Corning method, have eliminated all necessity for experimental expenditure. The building up of an egg farm is within the reach of any man who will follow the Corning plan herein described faithfully and persistently. The man or woman who determines to pursue some branch of the poultry industry must first decide what particular branch. Shall it be to raise poultry for market? If so, what? Squab broilers? Soft roasters? Or capons? Perhaps all of these. Some utility line is the best to start with. Fresh, sanitary eggs are a necessity and command the highest price in the market, daily, for spot cash, just as readily as stocks and bonds command a daily cash value in any financial market. There can be no better proof of the truth of this than the success of the Corning Egg Farm. Pullet range and colony houses, each house 6 feet × 10 feet built on skids movable. In whatever line a beginner decides to start, he needs to go straight down that line without deviation, taking as his motto, "This one thing I do." In the fullness of time, having established a reputation for the quality of his eggs and birds, the demand for his eggs for hatching purposes and for his birds as foundation stock for other people will naturally come to him, and it is very profitable. One certain fact should be settled in the understanding of every beginner, to wit, it is not possible to invest from $500 to $5,000 in the poultry industry and double your money in the first year, or even to earn 50% on the investment. Neither is it possible with $300 to build a laying house with a capacity for 500 birds, if the house is properly built for warmth and meets sanitary conditions. Housing for hens must be free from dampness. Concrete absorbs dampness, therefore avoid it. Any person starting in the poultry industry for profit and intending to follow it for a livelihood should begin in a small way, realizing that, like any other business venture, it must be built up and grow from year to year, and that certainly for the first year, no money can be drawn out for living expenses. These statements are made clearly and emphatically because quite the contrary has been given out as a fact. Such reckless representations, because untrue, are misleading and injurious to both those engaged in the poultry industry and also to those who contemplate entering it, and should be branded as false, and the authors of such statements should be prohibited from using the United States mails. We are not, and make no pretense of being, philanthropists. We have written this book primarily with the expectation that it will make the Corning Egg Farm and the Corning method of poultry culture even more widely and impressively known to the world, and so benefit us by increased demand for our stock, eggs, and all other goods we may have for sale. Secondly, we know that the book will benefit others if they will follow the Corning method and system herein laid down, and so prove of mutual advantage to readers and authors as well. The single comb white leghorn is par excellence the egg machine, provided always first class and the best strain of birds is procured, and the Corning strain, without doubt or question, is the very best strain of single-comb white leghorns yet developed anywhere in the world. We know this new, large, complete, and thoroughly up-to-date book will be the means of bringing us and our unequaled strain of single-comb white leghorns into favor with thousands of people who, as yet, do not know us, just as the publishing of the small and older booklet put us into touch with other thousands who are now doing a prosperous business by the use of this same Corning strain single-comb white leghorns, and by following the Corning method, now more completely elaborated and explained in the Corning Egg Farm book by Corning himself. Edward and Gardner Corning. The Corning Egg Farm, Bound Brook, New Jersey. December, 1911. End of Introductory. Chapter 1, The Building of the Corning Egg Farm. Having determined, in 1905, to engage in some business connected with the feathered tribe, we decided to try out the squab proposition versus market poultry. After searching over a period of many months in various parts of the country with the idea of finding a place where the existing buildings might be utilized for our needs, we finally were obliged to abandon this idea and purchased early in the year 1906 12.5 acres of land, now known as Sunny Slope Farm. This property lies about 2 miles west of Bound Brook, New Jersey, which town is reached by the Central Railroad of New Jersey, the Baltimore and Ohio, the Philadelphia and Reading, and the Lehigh Valley Railroads, and the farm is most accessible, as it is on the trolley line which connects Bound Brook and Somerville. In the early spring of 1906, we began our buildings, erecting a house for raising squabs, which would accommodate 500 pairs of breeding birds, a hen house of the scratching shed variety, capable of accommodating some 250 hens, and a workshop with living apartments for the resident man. We also sunk a well 117 feet deep, erecting over it a 60-foot windmill tower, which carries an 1,800-gallon tank. From this, pipes were laid to convenient parts of the property. 300 pairs of Homer pigeons were placed in the house built for that purpose, and we went diligently to work to prove that this was the quick and easy way to wealth, which the ingenious writers of squab literature proved so conclusively on paper. On the chicken side of the experiment, we seemed to lean, possibly because of the fact that squabs take one into the slaughterhouse business, towards one or more of the market breeds, and to meet the needs of this part of the business, we understood that any of the Rock family were best for the purpose. Started with 60 Buff Rock eggs. We purchased an incubator with the capacity of 60 eggs, being fearful of attempting the operation of a larger machine, because, like a great many novices, we had the feeling that an incubator was a very dangerous thing, and that anyone without a vast amount of experience should not attempt to handle it. We placed in this diminutive machine 60 Buff Rock eggs, and obtained a very fair hatch. With daily contact, our fear of the machine decreased, and we exchanged it for one with a capacity of 125 eggs, and this, in turn, was exchanged for one holding 250 eggs. Interior sterile laying house, No. 3 in 1910. We obtained fairly large flocks of youngsters that season, but, as we had the usual hallucination that poultry culture was really a miracle, and required neither work, capital, nor brains, that all you had to do was to accept the profit, and the chickens did it all themselves, we did not get so very far. The growth of the birds was so slow they did not reach a profitable weight until the broiler market had dropped the price to its lowest level. The pullets which we carried through the winter never produced an egg, for the simple reason that we had never studied the question out as to how the hen produces an egg. In other words, our lack of knowledge of the right methods was the reason for charging up a considerable loss instead of profit so far as the first season's work with hens went. We very early discovered there must have been a considerable amount of fiction in the writings on the squab industry. One reads that a pair of pigeons eats nothing like the amount of food which is required for one hen, and that they never eat more than their exact wants require, and that when they have young in the nest, this amount is very slightly increased. We found, however, that they ate in season and out of season. In fact, one recalls in this connection, and with considerable amusement, the song in the light opera Wang of the elephant who ate all day and the elephant who ate all night. During our work with pigeons, we tried out a number of different varieties: Homer's dragoons, runt dragoon crosses, Homer runt crosses, Maltese hens, and the various crosses with runt dragoons, also Carnot. We were led to buy these fancy breeds through the stories of extreme prices paid for large squabs, and we bred some heavy weights only to find, from the commission man who made a specialty of these birds, that it was impossible to pay the price which such birds were really worth, as trade for this class was extremely limited. Very early in our experience, we realized that the poultry side of our experiment was very much more to our liking and offered so much greater and more profitable outlook for our energies that we rang down the curtain on squab raising and turned our attention exclusively to the hen. While our minds were still running in the line of poultry for market purposes, we tried out the black Orpingtons, the idea being that on account of their size, they would make ideal roasting fowls. We found, however, that they were a very much inbred variety, and it was almost impossible to hatch the eggs. Out of 100 eggs, for which we paid $20, 8 chicks hatched, and these were not of sufficient vitality to live. Entrance to the farm in 1909. More money in eggs. During all this time, however, we were studying the poultry question, and had arrived at the conclusion that there was more money in eggs, properly produced and marketed, than in any other branch. One of the difficulties we met with in our investigations was the fact that so many different writers had such a variety of ideas on the same subject, and practically no two of them agreed on any given part of poultry culture. What seemed to us even more confusing was that, in most cases, the writer summed up his article by contradicting everything he had said in the previous chapters. We were finally forced to the conclusion that the raising of poultry had not yet been reduced to a science, but was almost entirely made up of guesses. In our investigations, however, we found in the writings of the late Professor Gawell of Maine an entirely different condition. He was the first man, so far as our observations went, who worked on the principle that effect followed cause in poultry as in everything else. We studied his bulletins with great interest and decided we would endeavor to prove that the same results gotten by him could be duplicated by others. Adopted white leghorns. We had also been studying the condition of the egg market, so far as New York and vicinity was concerned, and had found that this market paid a premium for a white-shelled egg. This, then, was the determining factor in the selection of the breed of fowls, and after gathering all the information we could regarding birds which laid white eggs, we were satisfied, taking everything into consideration, that for an egg farm, the single-comb white leghorn was the only fowl. In the spring of 1907, we collected a breeding pen, from different sources, of 30 single-comb white leghorn yearling hens and 3 strong, vigorous cockerels. We purchased an incubator holding 390 eggs and 3 outdoor brooders, and built a number of small colony houses to move the birds into as soon as they were large enough to be transferred from the brooders. The hens chosen for the initial breeding pen of the farm were most carefully selected, for even then we had in mind the result which we intended to reach as to the ultimate type of layer on the farm. We placed the resulting eggs from this breeding pen in the incubator, using a primitive turning machine to keep them in proper condition until the requisite number was acquired to fill the incubator. Our hatch was a very good one, and we succeeded in raising a fair number of the youngsters hatched. During the summer, we erected what is now known on the farm as the number one laying house. This was built 100 feet long by 12 feet wide, and on the same 20-foot section construction, which has proved to be so successful a plan for poultry houses. The one mistake in this house was its width, and that has now been remedied by widening it to the standard. 16 feet in width and 60 feet in length have been added to it. The youngsters on range grew rapidly. We marketed the cockerels at between 8 and 10 weeks of age, and they weighed from 1.25 pounds to 1.75 pounds. These were sold on the hoof, as we had decided for the future to do nothing in the slaughterhouse line, and to this decision we have strictly adhered, shipping alive also all culls and birds of any age showing imperfections, the majority of our stock finding ready market for breeding purposes when we are ready to dispose of it. As a correct record of the mortality of our hatching and the number of cockerels marketed had been kept, we found that we should have in the colony houses about 225 pullets to place in number one house. In catching up the birds, we found that the number figured on was about right. These 225 birds went into the house October 31st. They were already laying on the range. First use of roosting closets. It was a very interesting sight to us to watch these birds at work in the first house, which had ever been successfully built, without partitions, in other words, one large flock with the run of the entire house. Others had tried it and had failed. They had had drafts and had found the house, therefore, very undesirable. We conceived the idea of roosting closets with a partition extending some little distance beyond the dropping boards, running from the ceiling to the floor, thus breaking the house up so far as extended circulation of air went, and at the same time giving the birds the benefit of the larger area. It was also a matter of great interest to two novices to watch the egg output in this first house. On the first day of November, 5 eggs were gathered, on the second, 7, the third saw a drop to 4. Of course, these pullets had been giving us more eggs than this on the range, but a transfer from one place to another always means a setback to a layer. The middle of the month saw the hens producing above 17 eggs a day. December was started with an output of 40, and from that, the birds ran into larger numbers daily until the last of December, when, with the mercury registering well down around 0, they were turning out 100 eggs a day. The increase in the egg output continued steadily, and we found that March was the record month, but the highest single day was in April, when the pen produced 170 eggs. As you approach the Corning egg farm from the public highway in 1911, showing 264-foot brooder house, breeding cockerel house and office. We were well satisfied with the result of the winter's work with these pullets, and, although we did not have the knowledge that has since come to us in feeding for eggs, the output was a most creditable one, and we found a ready market at a good price. Early in the fall, we had mapped out our plans for a very decided increase in plant for the coming season. The excavation for the incubator cellar, 16 by 50 feet, had been made, and the brooder house above it was enclosed without difficulty before weather of any great severity overtook us. We were blessed with a very late fall, and mild weather continued, with only occasional dips, well into December 1907. We installed in the cellar 10 incubators, with a capacity of 390 eggs each. The brooder house, with its arrangement for hovers and nursery pens, was all completed, and the month of March found us placing eggs in the machines. In the fall of 1907, we had enlarged our breeding house, so that we were able to place in it some 250 breeders. Out of our original pen of 30, we had lost 2. From different sources, we bought yearling hens, and with our original 28, made up the breeding pen. Of course, as we had planned to endeavor to produce some 3,000 pullets for the fall of 1908, we were obliged to very materially supplement the product of our own breeders with eggs from other sources, and this we did, buying eggs from different breeders in widely separated territories. As the hatching season advanced, we added one more incubator to our battery of 10, and we placed in these incubators a total of 11,804 eggs, of which 2,096 showed dead germs and clear eggs on the 14th day test. The resulting number of chicks placed in the brooder house was 5,866 for the entire season. We found that the eggs purchased did not produce anything like the number of chicks, that is, strong, livable chicks, that did the eggs coming from our own breeding pen, which proved to us that the method of feeding and caring for breeding stock, pursued by others, fell very far short of the results gotten by our own methods. We count only livable chicks. The lesson of incubation, which it is so difficult to make people understand, is not so much a question of how many chicks may be hatched from a given number of eggs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.